the present day, of course, that would not fly in boardrooms today. But he never took stock options. He bought shares of his salary. And he wound up being, I think, the biggest landowner in the United States of America. He was, I think, the kind of an Ayn Rand hero. These days, you know, the so-called big three from Detroit troop to Washington, and they all look like, you know, the stock cardboard cutout Ayn Rand villains. In Henry Singleton, you have, to me, one of the true capitalists in thought, word, and deed. A wonderful man.
What do you think of this private jet hybrid car drive to Washington thing? I've been all morning. I've been going, I got to ask Jim Krant this question.
You know, I'm trying to think now which is the more transparently manipulative and objectable, the pathetic attempt at show of power and status by flying to Washington in a private jet, or the yielding to the political class and showing up in a hybrid car. It's like it reminds me of a dog licking the paw of his master. I don't know which is worse. They should have taken the bus.
A zillion chapters in this book, folks, all of them. These great newsletters from Grant's Interest Rate Observer. You've got two hills. Vernon Hill, we know from New Jersey banking. And you've got another Hill who did banking right. Carl Hill. What did the Southern Mr. Hill get right?
Well, Carl Hill was, I regret to say that he's no longer with us.
Oh, I didn't know that. Excuse me.
But Carl was a little bit the Henry Singleton of banking. He had this idea that you lend money against collateral, or you lend it against two people who are conducting a productive enterprise. You stay away from mortgages because mortgages are against houses, which are not earning assets but rather cost centers. So he built this bank in the distant out suburbs of Atlanta with great strategic thinking and not a little eccentricity. He invested some of the proceeds of his earnings in mining stocks, and before that in home builders. So he was, what was so wonderful about Carl Hill was his independence and his fearlessness of proceeding on his own way and on his own terms. He was an individual in an industry not much marked by individualism.
Hedge funds, Greenwich 2%, 20%, which, folks, is the way you're paid in a hedge fund. If you make money, that all goes out the window. If you don't make money, Jim Krant, is the hedge fund business forever changed?
Yes. Well, forever is a long time, of course. Hedge funds seem to vanish off the face of the earth late in the 60s and early in the 70s when so many of them did not perform as advertised. And it turns out they were not, after all, hedged. Similarly today, so few of them actually turn out to have been hedged, and now they become gated communities. You know, you can't have your money when you want it. However, hedge funds do have this redeeming quality. Their principals, their general partners, get paid when the fund makes money, and not so much when the fund doesn't. And furthermore, as partnerships, the general partners are on the line for their entire net worth should things go really bad. So, to me, still, there's something noble about the structure. I think that everything in Wall Street is carried to excess, and certainly the idea of the hedge fund has been as well. But the market is taking care of some of that excess. The population of funds will be shrinking by about 50% this year, and mediocre funds will have a very rough time of it.
Switch gears. I got to go to the theoretical lodestone of Mr. Market Calculates, folks, is this idea that nobody can go out of business anymore. Somehow there's a pain-free era or decade without consolidation. Quote in the book, one William J. Rochelle III, full disclosure, presently with Bloomberg News, one of our giant legal experts, but for years at Fulbright and Jaworski. And Jim Grant, if I may quote Attorney Rochelle, it's as if you were a trust in a state's lawyer and they declared a moratorium on death. Nobody can go out of business anymore, right?
Right, yeah.
Why is that?
Well, I'm going to now give my little sermon on failure. It seems to me that that one of America's unheralded strengths has been its capacity to fail and to live after that event.
It is a single legal distinction of our capitalism, isn't it?
Yeah, and you know, America, of all economies, has been the most tolerant of entrepreneurs who try and fail and then start over again. You know, Boone Pickens, I think, has like six or eight comebacks, and he's preparing for his next one. I think he's 82 years old. So, you know, there's a wonderful sense of forgiveness, capacity for redemption in this country, commercial redemption. And what is happening now is I think, very dangerous and very sad. That is to say, with all good intentions, but with disastrous results, the government is coming in to forestall failure in the name of systemic, saving the system. And, so we're going to save Detroit, right? So that's all those jobs, those are visible jobs. But by pouring money into what has been a terrifically, and speaking the word system, systemically mismanaged industry, what we don't know, we can't see, are the jobs that are not created, the alternatives that are not pursued because we're deploying resources into sustaining a really badly constructed structure. So there ought to be more failure, and therefore ought to be more success.
You have a new note out, inflation. Yes, we can. We talked a bit about that before. What kind of inflation are we going to see when this flips?
I think we're going to see an old-fashioned, all-American currency debasement. I was stumbling a few minutes ago trying to characterize the monetary policy of the Federal Reserve. I have recently ordered up the annual report for the German Reichsbank for 1924 mm-hmm. and 25 to read up on what it looked like in the preparation for the hyperinflation or the culmination of that hyperinflation. We are not on the verge yet of a truly disastrous inflation, but we are, I think, working up towards that. The Fed is monetizing, I say, turning into money everything it gets hands on. It is creating dollars in exchange for mortgages, for treasury bonds a little bit, for other securities a lot, mystery meat of all kinds. These efforts, as strenuous as they are, have not yet reversed the tide of debt destruction. So well and truly, we are in a deflation. But I think the counter efforts are so immense that it is a matter of time, and I think not that much time. I think fiscal quarters rather than years before there is a turn.
We declared a recession this week, folks, thanks to James Peterba and MBER. And if you go back and look at length, there's early 30s, late 30s. But forget about that with Jim Grant. We're going to go back in history to the real depression, which was the 1870s. One George Walker was given a 20-course dinner, 8 different wines on his exit to Paris as he reestablished the gold standard in some form or the other. Jim Grant, who was George Walker, and why should we redux the gold standard?
Walker was a financial and political figure from yesteryear, and his significance to me is he testified in hearings that were conducted in 1878 and 1879. This is towards the tail end of a depression that began in 1873, if you please, 5 years or so of depressed business activity. What he said was that America was kind of upside down in its mortgages, which sounds a little familiar. But he said, please do not print more dollars just to rescue me. He, too, was upside down. But once we get a dependable monetary standard, that is to say, in the day, a gold standard, we will be okay. And it turns out that was, I think, a pretty good call. We were indeed okay. And then Walker went off, became the consul general in Paris, and his friends sent him off in style. Now, the gold standard is the rule of law applied to money. A dollar is defined as a given weight of bullion. In the day, it was $20.67, I think, could be exchanged for an ounce. So there was an objective value to the dollar. They couldn't go creating dollars willy-nilly. The people in that day looked back at the hyperinflations of the French Revolution, of the American Revolution. They looked at the experience, the Civil War with greenbacks. They wanted none of that. The lessons of history to them were simply incontrovertible. They wanted a real monetary standard. So fast forward to the present day. Since 1971, a dollar has been a piece of paper of no inherent value, and the dollar can be created at no cost and seemingly without limit. The world simply can't get its fill. Now, either you think that is a sustainable state of affairs, or like me, you think that every judgment of history is against it. Believing that, the latter as I do, I'm looking around for alternatives, and I am a great non-believer in treasury yields at these low levels. I'm a great non-believer in the idea that this dollar standard, this world kind of paper currency improvisational standard we have, can be sustained.
Are you a believer in the stock market?
Well, I'm a believer in some stocks. I think what we call around here is the value restoration project, these awful days. The value restoration project recedes, but certainly in credit. Let me talk about bonds and loans, the so-called senior securities. There are more and more bargains surfacing. So these are hard days. The news is just awful, unremittingly bad. And yet, for an investor, these are the good old days. You know, these are the times when professionals make their money. These are the times when serious amateurs make their money. Now is a time when security analysis is coming back in. So there's a lot to be said for a bear market, not least the opportunities it affords to seekers after value.
Bullish on Tata, Jim Grant on India. Can Tata and the Indian economic experiment continue even with this tragedy?
Yes. Yeah. It's too awful. But humanity is a pretty sturdy race, and I think what's going on in India is wondrous and basically irrepressible. And with the passage of time, this wound will heal and we'll be off to the races again.
Which is your favorite essay in here? Is there one that Jim Grant says, wow, that's the one I'm proud of?
Like my children tell me, I love them all equally.
Oh, please. Give me one in Mortgage Science Project. Well, Find That Risk.
Yes, Mortgage Science Project part.